Warren Buffett today is a multi-billionaire, one of the richest people on earth. But he started out as an ordinary young man with a dream of making millions. In this video, I'm going to show you a clip of Buffett answering the question on how to invest small amounts of money and turn it into big sums.
Mr. Buffett, how can I make $30 billion?
Start young. Charlie's always said that the big thing about it is we started building this little snowball on top of a very long hill. So we started at a very early age in rolling the snowball down. And, of course, the snowball, the nature of compound interest is it behaves like a snowball, a sticky snow. And the trick is to have a very long hill, which means either starting very young or living to be very old. I would do it exactly the same way if I were doing it in the investment world. I mean, if I were getting out of school today and I had $10,000 to invest, I'd start with the A's. I would start going right through companies, and I probably would focus on smaller companies because I would be working with smaller sums, and there's more chance that something is overlooked in that arena. And as Charlie has said earlier, it won't be like doing that in 1951 when you could leaf through and find all kinds of things that just leapt off the page at you. But that's the only way to do it. I mean, you have to buy businesses or little pieces of businesses called stocks, and you have to buy them at attractive prices, and you have to buy them and you have to buy into good businesses. And that advice will be the same 100 years from now in terms of investing. That's what it's all about. And you can't expect anybody else to do it for you. I mean, people will not tell you about wonderful little investments. It's not the way the investment business is set up. When I first visited GEICO in January of 1951, I went back to Columbia, and that rest of that year, I subsequently went down to Blythe & Company, and actually to one other firm that was a leading, Geyer & Company, that was a leading analyst in insurance. And, you know, I thought I'd discovered this wonderful thing, and I'd see what these great investment houses that specialized in insurance stocks said, and they said I didn't know what I was talking about. You know, it wasn't of any interest to them. You've got to follow your own, you know, you've got to learn what you know and what you don't know, and within the arena of what you know, you have to pursue it very vigorously and act on it when you find it. And you can't look around for people to agree with you. You can't look around for people to even know what you're talking about. You know, you have to think for yourself. And if you do, you'll find things.
Mr. Buffett, I want to ask you this question last week when I ran into you after Gillette's annual meeting, but I choked. So now that there's no pressure, here goes. In the years from 1956 through 69, you achieved the best results of your career quantitatively, 29% annually against only 7% for the Dow. Your approach then was different than now. You look for lots of undervalued stocks with less attention to competitive advantage or favorable economics and sold them rather quickly. As your capital base grew, you switched your approach to buying undervalued excellent companies with favorable long-term economics. My question is, if you're investing a small sum today, which approach would you use?
Well, I would use the approach that I think I'm using now of trying to search out businesses where I think they're selling at the lowest price relative to the discounted cash they would produce in the future. But if I were working with a small amount of money, the universe would be huge compared to the universe of possible ideas I work with now. You mentioned that 56 to 69 was the best period. Actually, my best period was before that. It was from right after I met Ben Graham in early 1951. But from the end of 1950 through the next 10 years, actually returns averaged about 50% a year. And I think they were 37 points better than the Dow per year, something like that. But that I was working with a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of money. And so I would pour through volumes of businesses, and I would find one or two that I could put $10,000 into or $15,000 into that were just were ridiculously cheap. And obviously, as the money increased, the the universe of possible ideas started shrinking dramatically. The times were also better for doing it in that time. But I think if you're working with a small amount of money, with exactly the same background that Charlie and I have, and same ideas, same whatever ability we have, you know, I think you can make very significant sums. But as soon as you start getting the money up into the millions, many millions, the curve on expectable results falls off just dramatically. But that's the nature of it. When you get up to things you can put millions of dollars into, you've got a lot of competition looking at that, and they're not looking as I did when I started. When I started, I went through the pages of the manuals page by page. I mean, I probably went through 20,000 pages in the Moody's Industrial, Transportation, Banks, and Finance manuals, and I did it twice. And I actually, you know, looked at every business. I didn't look very hard at some. Well, that's not a practical way to invest tens or hundreds of millions of dollars. So I would say if you're working with a small sum of money and you're really interested in the business and willing to do the work, you will find something if you were. There's no question about it in my mind. You will find some things that promise very large returns compared to what we will be able to deliver with large sums of money. Charlie?
Well, yeah, I think that's right. A brilliant man who can't get any money from other people and is working with a very small sum probably should work in very obscure stocks, searching out unusual mispriced opportunities. But, you know, that's such a small world. It may be a way for one person to come up, but it's a long slog.
Yeah, most smart people, unfortunately, in Wall Street figure that they can make a lot more money, a lot easier, just by one way or another, you know, getting an override on other people's money or delivering services in some way that people... And the monetization of hope and greed, you know, is a way to make a huge amount of money. And right now, it's very, just take hedge funds. I mean, I've had calls from a couple of friends in the last month that don't know anything about investing money. They've been unsuccessful and everything else. And, you know, one of them called me the other day and said, well, I'm forming a small hedge fund, $125 million he was talking about. And, you know, like the thought that since it was only $125 million, maybe we ought to put in $10 million or something of the sort. I mean, if you looked at this fellow's Schedule D on his 1040, for the last 20 years, you know, you'd think he ought to be mowing lawns, but he may get his $125 million. I mean, you know, and it's just astounding to me how willing people are during a bull market just to toss money around because they, you know, they think it's easy. And of course, that's what they felt about Intersense stocks a few years ago. They'll think about something else next year too, but the biggest money made, you know, in Wall Street in recent years has not been made by great performance, but it's been made by great promotion, basically.
Charlie, do you have anything?
Well, I would state it even more strongly. I think the current scene is obscene. I think there's too much mania, there's too much chasing after easy money, there's too much misleading sales material about investments, there's too much on the television emphasizing speculation in stocks.